Any adjustments to the agenda?
Whatever, whatever. Just in case I want to.
Okay, hearing none, we'll deem the agenda approved by consensus. Third item on the agenda is comments from the chair. Last meeting, we did not have a quorum. So we had a working session and we discussed ideas for moving the city plan process forward. John came up with some good ideas, and we'll get into some more details when we get to the city plan item on IEP, but I just want to kind of highlight from a high level some of the ideas we kicked around. One of the big one, I think, is we need to be working off a map at this point in time. It'll be the most productive way to kind of figure out how we want to drill down here and there, but first we'll look at a big map and make seek input on what the public and other members of the commission want to evolve, maintain, or transform. And so we have some capabilities of being able to do this with layers that is not available quite yet, but it's probably coming in the near future. So we haven't ironed out all the details, but the basic gist is we want to be able to distribute this map with clear instructions, which we have to figure out what they are. And in the meantime, Mike is going to start just depositing materials into the Google Drive, and you're going to try to roughly categorize them so that they're easier to sort through.
In my hard drive, I just haven't started to drag them over yet. I was getting them organized in one place, and then I can pull them all over.
Okay. So.
And will they go into different files in the?
I don't know. I'll probably work with John to figure out how best to organize.
And once you have it down, we'll probably walk through it. I mean, people should feel free to play around with it. But we could probably just do a walkthrough at one of the meetings later. Yeah, so then the other comments I have is just that, you know, as you see on our agenda, we have some last final items for dealing with the zoning fixes. I'd really like if we could finish them today so we can move on to the city plan. Catch myself. So that's my plan, is like, let's really focus on these zoning rewrites. Let's get done with some of the less interesting stuff, but very necessary and important. And then we can move into the more exciting development of the city plan. So fourth item of the agenda is when we invite members from the public who are present to come up and give comments on something not on the agenda, but we have no members of the public here. So we'll move on to item 5, which is the final punch list items for zoning fixes. Mike.
All right. You had the four numbers there, 15, 83, 84, and 131. So we'll just start at the top.
But I think it's still.
So 15.
And can I look on with someone? Because I could not find my copy of this for some reason.
And I've got a
so you could just bug me through.
All right.
One.
This is the channelized, right?
This is the channelized, unchannelized. So when city council adopted the zoning at one of the last meetings coming up, they decided they would insert.
Oh, you have it on your
So they decided they would insert into the zoning requirement, because we had a requirement that had, we actually were allowing like balconies and things to overhang the waters, especially on the North Branch, because there already are on Elm Street.
Mm-hmm.
So the first thing they did was remove that, and then they wanted to see more green space. And
by remove that, what do you mean?
Just remove
to be
that
clear.
Requirement out of the zoning.
Okay.
So it went to a zero setback.
Okay.
And then the question came in, there was a push from, well, basically one person who really wanted to push to see that there was more green space, more riparian vegetation along the corridor, even through the downtown. And so the compromise that came out was that there was a determination that if something was already channelized, then it wouldn't have to meet that requirement. It could still be zero setback or 10-foot, whatever the requirement is for that district. But if it's unchannelized, then you would have to meet the riparian setback requirements. And it was gonna have to be, I think, a 15-foot riparian buffer. So that turned out to be a little bit challenging because we didn't have a definition of what channelized is and we didn't have any rules. So what you have on the map is basically, I went through and looked at where we have river walls and I colored them in orange. And then there's a couple of spots near the confluence which have some green dots. Those are areas where the DRB has already kind of made a determination because they didn't have rules and there were projects going on. The DRB had to make a determination, is this channelized or is it not channelized? And they determined those were already channelized. So we could make rules that overrule that, but that's basically the back parking lot of the Jacobs lot and on the other side of the river. And then down near Confluence Park that's proposed, there's also a small section that's not. That actually hasn't been gone through DRB for channelization, but it's very similar to the other ones. The only spot that I could find that really was not river wall channelized was kind of that state portion from the railroad bridge down to Bailey. That's about the only stretch that's not, doesn't have river walls.
Does it have any other kind of retainage at all?
I'm sure it's got buried something in there to keep the river from eroding in, but there's nothing really formal that's there. So the couple options we have are to eliminate the channelized, you know, and kick it back to the council to go through and say we think you erred on the last time by including it. The other option would be to adopt this map or to adopt some reference to this, because really what the DRB needs is some clarity of what's channelized, what's not channelized. And if this is the only thing that we can find that's not channelized, then let's just say that's not channelized and adjust the regulations.
And where is this in the regulations?
3005, okay. I believe.
Oh, yeah.
Well, in this case, it's where number 15 is noting it is in figure 2-01, which is urban center 1.
Yeah, that didn't
it just
line up.
Oh, the channel requirement that was passed only applies to urban center?
Urban center, yeah, because we had exempted riparian buffers in urban 1, 2, and 3.
Okay.
They went through and said,
this is a compromise.
Yeah.
We'll add it into 1, 2, and 3, but only where the stream isn't channelized.
Okay. So we never intended for there to...
We never did, no.
What I'm getting at is for outside the urban center, though, we did intend for there to be riparian buffers.
Yes, and there are.
Yeah.
And you're looking at urban center too?
You don't remember?
The second part I hadn't. I remember I was the one who went to City Council.
I know.
So is that why you're...
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't remember what you did? Which is sometimes true, but yeah, I do remember.
Well,
they're
note 2 under those...
I was there too.
It was
what we
sections.
Did together. That's all right, Kirby. So I'm 2-01 is the urban center 1 dimensional standard. So I think it's just an incorrect citation.
It is technically there because it's under water setbacks.
Oh, okay. Oh, I see.
20 feet or as per note 2.
Note 2.
Except in channelized sections where the river setback will be zero.
Got it. Sorry, I missed that.
Yeah, so the two sections kind of work together.
Okay. And then 3005E1 talks about this.
I guess... As far as the city planning that we're going to be doing goes, I take it we're going to be having conversations about what we will do about maybe making the city more river oriented. Is this stretch, this small stretch that we're talking about that's not channelized, that this would apply to, is it something that we would maybe plan long term to have as park or green anyway?
It's mostly state land, except for the last parcel, which I believe is owned by the credit union. So I think the bigger challenge for doing anything with that is that it's mostly,
That's where the bike path is, right? It's the bike path and.
Bike path is on the other side.
Other side there.
Oh, right. Oh, it's the parking lot, yeah.
Yeah, it's the state, little state parking lots that kinda.
Yeah.
Tuck in there. I mean, I'm sure there are a lot of things we would like to do or like to see changed in that area, but I think a lot of that's gonna come down to negotiations with BGS and. I don't think we'd be forcing things through with regulations on the state.
Okay, I mean, that, in some ways you answered what I was kinda getting at, was like, to what extent is it moot?
Yeah, it probably doesn't matter a whole lot, whatever we decide to do.
Right. Right.
And probably should be explicit about it in the plan about.
Mm-hmm.
More towards about the direction of where we want things to head.
So Mike, is it, will there be a effect on the Confluence Park development? Given the, our determination that it's channelized?
It actually helps it if it's channelized. Because if it's unchannelized, then you have to meet the buffer and the setback, and then you wouldn't be able to put in a number of the things that you, that people want. Because it's a measurement from the top of bank, so if you went to One Taylor Street and said you had to meet a 15-foot setback, then you can't have any of those different seating structures because it's supposed to be natural riparian buffer.
Okay, so we don't have any other requirements for a channelized section of the river and non-development of those areas then? There's nothing in the zoning ordinance?
Not in the zoning ordinance for that specific, because it's a setback of zero. So if it's channelized and has a hard wall, then it's a zero setback.
I mean, the hard wall along there is not continuous, so I mean,
no, there are a couple of gaps in there.
Okay.
But the river can't really meander with that little gap, those gaps.
Yeah, throughout any of this area, it's not like it's gonna go anywhere. But
yeah.
So is there I'm sorry if I missed this, but is there a urgency to making this decision, or is this something we can kind of kick until after we've worked on this section in the city plan?
It certainly counts as a fix in that the council said to have a channelized, you know, to regulate differently between channelized and unchannelized, and we, the DRB, has had to basically make a case-by-case basis for each one of these as to whether something is channelized or unchannelized, because it's not really defined, and a map would be the best way to resolve it, to kind of go and identify which areas are channelized and which areas aren't. And according to the engineers who came up and testified for both projects on the east and the west of the north branch, they both said, you know, according to Army Corps of Engineers, even though those don't have river walls, those are still channelized based on engineering standards.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I would probably guess almost all of this would probably meet that same definition all the way through, which makes most of it moot, which basically means we would go back to city council and say none of this is unchannelized. And if that's the argument we want to make, we can go back and see what city council does. But
why don't we do that, or just say this, consider this area channelized in this map, because
including the area that's designated with your green line currently. Would we say that was not part of the channelized section along here? So that's not considered channelized then?
Well, it's up to us at this point if we want to or not.
It hasn't yet been determined to be.
Okay, right.
It's not obviously channelized.
It
hasn't been determined to be channelized, but we could here.
We could determine that it is.
And I think if we determined that it is channelized, then we would just go to city council and make a recommendation to remove that addition that they put in.
Oh.
Which addition? What do you mean?
The addition that they added this, the city council added this language in.
Right.
Due to Steve Cease's.
So we'd be essentially finding everything within the urban core as
channelized,
and therefore this would be superfluous language, which we would just ask them to remove rather. Well, if we do that, I think we need a memo, because, or some, maybe not in written form, but we should explain, because we did recommend that there were no riparian, there was no setback in the urban center. After hearing testimony, the city council made this decision to have a channelized determination. And I think, you know, Kirby and I were there for that, and I think we probably figured, well, everything at urban center is channelized, so it's effectively the same.
But we didn't consciously know at the time that the compromise they ended up with was pretty much giving us exactly what we wanted.
Right, like, so...
The DRB could have seen this and taken testimony and said, no, when we took testimony on the Jacobs lot and took testimony on the Heaney lot projects, that both of those were going to find, if they had found both those to be unchannelized despite testimony, then we would be having a different conversation. Mm-hmm. The fact that,
yeah,
I think what Steve was thinking of was those areas should be considered unchannelized, but even those the DRB found to be channelized.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, I mean, just from my conversations with him, my understanding was he was thinking about backyards, so that wouldn't have been these spots here.
Yeah, further up.
It would be, yes, it would be, yeah, further up where he would have been concerned.
Yeah, and a number of those I looked and you could see the river wall. It was still there along the upper part. You can probably see from your porch.
Mm-hmm.
You can still see it's kind of pushed in there, but it's there.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. You can also see everyone dumping their snow in the river from that porch, too.
Yes.
I thought they weren't doing that.
Nobody's supposed to do it.
The municipality can't.
Yeah, here's the stretch we're talking about. You can't,
yes,
possibly get closer to the river there.
Right, so you kind of show everyone here. I mean, it's not a backyard where aesthetic value is going to be high. I mean, I just think we,
yeah,
need to be thoughtful about how we present this change, you know, if we're going to do it.
I think we should mention that, you know, we didn't know at the time, but we now realize that the compromise solution means that there's essentially no non-channelized sections, and that we ask that it be removed. I think from a law perspective, we should be removed if we're going to, there shouldn't be a moot rule or a pointless rule in there that should be removed, because that could create legal trouble later.
But then we need to present something that indicates all of that area being channelized. Or generally just say that, leave the language that there are no unchannelized sections in the urban core too. Is that what you're looking for?
Well, I'll draft a memo. If the decision is that we're going to consider all of this channelized, was that going to be your thought, John? Was that even this section is channelized?
I'm not hearing strong...
Yeah, either.
Concerns to the contrary. I mean, how do people feel about making a determination that all of this area is indeed channelized and that there should be no water setback?
I think that's one way to deal with it. The other is to say that if we do want to pull something out as not channelized, then what Mike's done is fine.
And I want to, just as background, I know that Aaron definitely wasn't here for this discussion. I can't remember if you were, Ariane, but we kind of went around about it and settled on a determination that water quality is not really going to be, it's not, you're not going to have any sort of purifying or water quality benefits to a riparian buffer in this particular area. The river has been channelized like this for so long, and we've built up on it that it just, this is sort of a policy decision that we made a long time ago, and it would wreak a lot of havoc to change that now. It's not to say that we don't care about the river, it's just that when John and I met with Sasha Peeler from A&R, she recommended that we focus our efforts on ensuring that the river had meander room in the North Branch, you know, up past the downtown, that would help with flooding that would help with water quality, and that as far as the downtown is concerned, we can deal with water quality a little bit more comprehensively with stormwater, the stormwater system. And we haven't, we need to move forward on that, but we haven't yet. But that's sort of the thought, is we'd be more comprehensive there. And if we only have like a patch here or there of riparian buffer, then everything's going to get sheet flow there.
Everything's going to get what?
It's going to get funneled.
Oh, funneled.
To that spot.
Yeah. Yeah, essentially that there's not very much to be gained in terms of water quality with that regulation, and that a non-regulatory approach would probably yield a lot more in terms of water benefit, water quality benefits than sort of a blunt instrument of saying, you know, don't develop 15 feet from here, even though it's already all developed.
Right. I think it's a good practice, but we have to be thoughtful about where we're putting it, that rule.
I mean, any structures in that area would be pretty severely limited, because that area is all in the flood hazard area.
Yeah, so they have to build up.
Up, yeah, really. Or else they're going to, you know, build up to a floodplain, which is something we don't want to do in that area either. So,
well, thank you for that context. That was helpful.
Yeah, I mean, we thought of, I mean, water quality is very important to me. It's a very dear issue to my heart. Yeah. So I saw that as kind of like, wait, we have to work through this.
And for the northern section that still has its river corridor that's in like good shape, I think we're one of the first communities in the state that have like a river corridor regulation, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep. And we were also taking things in steps. So prior to 2018, there were no riparian buffers as requirements at all. You know, there were no slope requirements, no riparian buffer requirements. There were no wetland requirements. So, you know, in the new zoning, in a couple of places, we went through to go through and say, in riparian buffers, we're not going to worry about them in the downtown, mostly because we were looking at the fact that we have just added regulations to all these other places. And if in the future we want to take an incremental step about trying to figure out how to introduce that more in the downtown, that was going to be a question for a later time, we thought. So I've got a little bit, so I will draft a memo when we've got our public hearing. I'll let us go through and approve that. That kind of just goes and determines it's all channelized, and therefore we've recommended removing it.
Is everyone comfortable with that?
I really think that's slightly better to say that it's all channelized, just because I think we're all seem to be in agreement that it's kind of pointless to call this out, to call that one section out as not channelized. And chances are the state's going to be able to preempt whatever we do. But there could be a complication caused, and to what end, or what's to be gained, you know? So that's why I think it's slightly better, cleaner, just to call it channelized as error.
It feels more honest, I guess.
Yeah.
I feel like the only reason we'd be leaving it in is for some kind of like, politically it becomes more palatable to at least have something included, but if we're being honest, like if it's not gonna make a difference, why do we have this regulation?
That's why we need to explain it though.
Right, and then it becomes more complicated, I guess.
Well, I'll try to put something together that's relatively short to the point on that. I don't think it has to be too complicated.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'd be happy to give you comments if you want.
Yeah, I can circulate it.
Okay.
So, do we have a decision on 15 and move on?
Yeah. Barb, Aaron, Ariane, feel okay about?
Yeah,
okay.
Okay.
Art studio.
You
want to
get for
83? Art studio, yeah.
Art studio.
Oh.
Thank you, John.
Oh, did you miss the definition?
I think my requirement was painting studio.
Yeah, and I looked for that actually when I printed the. It is a painting. It's not an art.
Okay.
found it.
You found it, I found it. Painting studio means a use of land or structure for the creation of art through the application of paint, pigments, colors, or other medium on a solid surface. All other art studios shall be considered light manufacturing. What I did was a dictionary search of what painting was, and that's what came up, so.
Mm-hmm.
It does say other media, so it could be.
It's still only the application of paint. That was really what we were more concerned about, was that the other forms of art can sometimes be loud if it's creating metal sculptures.
For sure.
Polishing granite or.
I guess my thought
is
just.
Art? Yes.
Hollywood.
Well, that was what.
Did you
that
learn
was
that at Marlboro College?
No, that was what.
Slytherin.
What is justice?
Slytherin school.
But we did have a little bit of that conversation of once you have art, you know, somebody, when we were just talking about art generically, not painting, somebody could say, I'm a band, and therefore, you know, I can.
So
if we give too
art.
Much of an exemption, we would end up with,
right.
You know, that's art, and therefore.
So my thought is it's more about the noise level than it is about the actual activity.
Which is why we made it into light manufacturing. Light manufacturing tends to also have similar. In certain districts, it's permitted, and those are districts that you'd probably have other noisy uses. In other districts, it's conditional, and we can take a look at whether it's appropriate for that. That particular art studio happens to be polishing granite or.
Yeah. We'll flag this one for Glenn on the council.
Mm. He'll probably pick up on it.
He can.
And it's still all allowed as a your home-based occupation.
Yeah, if it's home-based, it ends up in a different category. This is for ones where people. We had an application in the downtown. Somebody wanted to have a studio where they were doing painting here in the downtown on the second floor, and we really didn't have a use to kind of pigeonhole it into, so that was why it came up for consideration in the fix-it list. And the decision was, you know, we should be able to exclude this one. If it's a painting studio in your home, it's going to probably be exempt altogether. But
this definition seems fine to me.
I would suggest we add photography in there too, which seems similar to painting. So I could see that easily coming up in the
mm-hmm.
same context.
The quiet arts.
Yeah, this is right.
Sounds like a movie title.
And I'm sure people are going to come up with ones that they're just going to get us.
Yeah, we're going to need public input on this.
We're
going to
get
sure.
We're going to get beat up. This just happened to be the one that came out, and I don't know how else to. Fix this one, but
will it? Would it be trouble if we just said application of any media to a fixed surface, hard surface? Is that what your definition?
Solid
is?
Surface.
Solid surface. Oh. Yeah. Solid surface then could potentially involve sculpture.
What if you painted sculptures?
I'm just thinking that photography. As Kirby said, also fabric art, all those kinds of things. They're pretty quiet.
Yeah, photography now is just sitting in front of a computer and printing things. It's not like
painting
a dark room.
Yeah, you have to mount
it. I gotta get printed somehow, right?
Mm. Print.
Yeah, but I think most of those would come under professional services.
Oh.
It's gonna be more of a service than it will be.
Hmm.
So how do galleries fit then?
Galleries are their own use.
They're defined.
Yeah,
okay.
that's a public. This is.
Ah, right.
This is strictly
public,
the artist and their media.
Well, unless we have any other ideas, let's put this out to the public and get some input. Sound good?
Sounds good.
Okay.
So that means we're accepting it.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right, and so change of use. I don't know if we. Is that the next one? Change
yeah.
of use? 84. I don't think we have to go through this one. This actually was in the regulations, and I didn't know it. So,
oh.
The only change in change of use was to add, change of use means an increase in the intensity of an existing use or an increase in intensity beyond a limit established under an existing permit, including the addition of a dwelling unit. So that was just added in there to reflect the fact that in our use table we had single and two family in one line, and three and four family in another line, and therefore, and somebody had already made this argument, because they were going from three units to four units, they weren't actually needing to get a permit. And that's not the intention of grouping those together, it was just to save space in the table. So by putting this in, it just kind of gives us that thing to go through and say, no, 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 change of use may be that, but if you're adding units,
okay. And does this coincide with the building code, our building code? Because they determine some requirements based on change of use.
Yeah, building code operates under its own set of rules.
So
yeah, we might just end up with a totally different definition.
And it happens in a lot of cases that the definitions are different between the various ordinances depending on where they come from. Just like the definition of development is different for flood hazards than it is for zoning, because the federal sets the rule for flood hazard development.
Yeah, they're pretty specific about their change of use definition.
All right. Everyone good with that? Looks good to me. 131.
So 131 was really just kind of a larger strike out, replace. I didn't make copies of this one, probably should have. So what it was, it came down to the enforcement rules. And I put in there that they were too restrictive and not organized well. So our zoning administrator reviewed the river hazard area provisions, which follow the same state statutes, and found them to be much clearer. So we just kind of transposed those over, and I made a strikeout copy of that.
And that's in the bigger copy that you sent us.
Yes.
Where is that?
So this
page
is
page 4-23.
So it would no longer be in 470?
Chapter 470.
No, it's still in chapter 470.
It would be, and it would remain there. Okay.
Yeah, and it would remain there. And really what the big issue that came up was in a lot of cases, I usually insert in regulations that I've written a provision that gives the administrative officer the right to negotiate settlements of ways of coming into compliance, because the way this was written, she didn't have any ability. So we had a project on Court Street where somebody put something in the wrong place, and in December we told them they had to move it. It's buried under snow, and they agreed, we'll move it as soon as the snow melts. Well, officially, the way it's written, she can't even write an agreement that goes through and say, you agree to do this, I agree to do this. The notice of violation stays in effect, but I'm not pursuing enforcement beyond that because we have an agreement that you're going to fix it. And this could happen for landscaping or something else. So this would just give her a little bit of the rights to go through and say, you can write these agreements that go through and, there are limits. She can't allow things to happen. Any agreement shall be signed by the violator and the administrative officer, shall establish a minimum reasonable timeline for curing the violation, give written authorization to allow the administrative officer to inspect the premises upon completion or the agreed upon date of completion to ensure compliance where the property owner fails. Blah, 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 goes through a bunch of things. So it just gives us an amicable way to work with property owners without.
You have a little typo in 4702A7, just the second line. It should be administrative officer And just is missing the R, that's all. It says office.
Oh, yeah, there it is. Good eye.
Let's see, quite a bit more here. Interesting, because I would argue that the ability to enter into agreements might be inherent in the authority.
The way statute is written is the administrative officer must literally follow the zoning, and that's the way it's actually in statute.
Oh, okay.
You must literally follow, and therefore,
hmm.
And this sometimes, you know, a lot of times we'll not do it anyways, but if you're in a case where you've got two neighbors who really don't get along, you could be getting beaten up because we are required to fine them $150 a day, and somebody may just get their kicks out of the fact that they're going to push the city and box them into a corner that goes and says, you have to fine him $150 a day because you literally have to enforce the rules, and that's what the rules say. So giving a little bit of an out, in a lot of cases, people aren't complaining, or we'll get a complaint, and we just figure out, yeah, we've got an agreement, they know to fix it, and they're going to fix it. As soon as the weather's there, and nobody cares, but for people who want to make a big deal about it.
Yeah. Any concerns with the enforcement provisions?
I only have one that's minor. I sort of wonder about the appropriateness of the word amicable as a means of resolving the violations. It's an alternative means of resolving a violation.
Okay.
But
I'm okay with that.
I just feel like it's not what characterizing the resolution.
Yeah, just say resolution.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
so yep. It's an alternative means of resolving. I could just see somebody who violates, who reads this, and like, I'm not, it's not amicable to me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to be friendly about it.
Yeah, good call.
Well, we don't have to sign an agreement.
Yeah.
This is just our way to
right.
be nice
yeah.
to you.
I don't
this
have to
is
be
us
happy
to be
about
nice
this.
To you.
Right.
So where do we have here?
That is... 47
B.
Is what I'm looking at.
As an alternative?
Yeah. It's a very minor issue. But
no.
It just sort of struck me.
It's got a...
Mm-hmm. Okay. Sounds like it's approved with that minor change.
Okay.
So... Let's talk about Kirby and Barb's memos.
I was wondering if that was, is it part of number six?
I don't have number six in front of me,
five?
But, oh, item six.
Report.
Yeah.
No, let's do it now.
Because the written report's written now.
Well, yes, let's start. Item six. We'll do it under item six. Upcoming adoption process for zoning. So let's first talk about the memo that Barb and Kirby drafted and revised and provided us. I think the last one was emailed from Kirby.
He actually had two.
Right.
Two emails.
Right. Yes, and I have a printed copy here, I think. So if anyone doesn't have it.
I don't.
Yep, here we
go.
So I think, I mean, they're dated February 20th, so that might have been the day that you emailed them. I'm not sure.
That seems right.
Do you have a printed copy? Leslie, do you have an extra printed copy?
I don't.
I didn't think you were going to take this up.
Okay. I just have... Why don't...
You want me to run them through the printer? Copier?
Check and see. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, why don't we... Do people need copies, or do you have them up on your screens already? Because we can go print, we can go copy them right now.
I've abstained from this one. I'm going to continue to use them, so.
So...
I can look at the one.
This is only one of them.
Mike's holding the other.
Mike's holding it.
So the one with track changes is the one that I think you wrote, Barb, and Kirby edited. Is that accurate? And then the other one is Kirby's standalone memo, if we want to do it that way.
There's so from the email that I sent, there's two attachments. One says that I said it's the joint council memo, which would be to get into the specifics of it. I had written, I think, a couple of drafts, and then Barb had altered one, which I would consider Barb's version. And then, so this joint memo is me further editing Barb's memo.
Right.
But
okay.
I actually generated another one after that. After we met, I generated another one that was a standalone memo, which I thought take into consideration your issues.
So
did I work off of that one?
Yeah. Then I think the only thing that came back was you provided both, and I had a, you know, very minor, like a one-word revision to the one. But it wasn't clear to me from your email if you were proposing to send both memos or not.
No.
So I have a strong preference to send one memo.
Yes, yeah.
And it seems like we're in a good position to do that.
Yeah, and I believe that's the last I heard. I think Barb said that she's fine with the joint memo, which was my edits to one of her versions. So I think that's where we are, as far as I understand it.
Nothing jumped out at me when I read it. I mean, I haven't read it since I prepared for the last meeting, but
yeah,
I could tell you that nothing jumped out at me, or I would have.
It felt good.
It felt good, and if the two of you are satisfied with it, then I'm.
Yeah, I mean, I
have no concerns.
Yeah, I still have a minor issue with one deletion, but. Under advantages, was deleted the section. The wording was deleted, deemed necessary, so eliminates lengthy administrative work deemed necessary by the planning office. I'm not sure why that got deleted.
That was deleted because I want to make sure that the tone of what we send is one where we're taking Mike's word for what the issue was. And so deemed necessary suggests that we're skeptical of the issue that was presented, when I don't think that the city or the Planning Commission as a whole was skeptical.
Oh, I don't think, I mean, deemed necessary by the planning office is because they're the ones doing the work. We're not necessarily making a judgment about that. I mean, I have gotten questions from previous Planning Commission members saying, I thought we did have a method for determining that fairly simply. So, anyway, I just...
Is there another way to word that so that it accomplishes what you're looking for without maybe triggering any sort of concern about skepticism?
I thought the meaning stayed the same by deleting it. I thought it still presents what the issue was. It says, by deleting those two words, it still says, eliminates lengthy administrative work by the planning office.
Yeah, but who's making that determination? That it's lengthy administrative work is a qualification, making it. So now in this case, we're making that determination.
Right, we're taking the planning office's word for it. We're holding that at face value. We're not questioning that. And that's, I think, what the point of that deletion is.
Exactly.
Right?
Why don't we just take out lengthy, and then we can say eliminates administrative work by the planning office, and I'll be fine. That way we're not making a determination ourselves on how lengthy it is without having seen evidence. Does that sound all right?
Yeah, we can do that, and Mike, you can explain your concerns. And how you presented that to us, if you want.
Yes.
Okay, sure.
Does that sound good to everybody? Okay.
I had one other proposed edit on where it says this, and for disadvantages, this change could allow for increased density on steep sites and or development on steep slopes. I think density is just like a measure. So I think what this could do is allow for an increase of housing units on parcels that have steep slopes or wetlands.
Well, it's not just housing units, but maybe saying increased buildings on steep slopes.
Well, so density is not a measure of buildings, though.
Yeah, but
all it is the number of households we're talking about.
Is it strictly related to housing units?
That's what our density.
Except for
I think, yeah, we could. Well, so, do you think we could change density to units placed on steep slopes?
Well, they would be on sites that contain it, because we're not changing the regulations around what you can actually do or not do. We're just saying if a site has this, then the maximum allowable residential units you can build on it go up. So it doesn't mean that it'll necessarily be on that steep part of the slope. It's just saying if a parcel has this.
So what this bullet point it was trying to get to, though, was that it is possible that there's some construction on either the wetlands or the steep slopes, because we had already suggested to make the change that some construction could be done with an engineering plan.
Right.
So that's actually what this bullet is trying to get to, is that it's feasible that there could be construction on steep slopes as a result of this change.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's actually the result.
The result
of the
other change.
The two in combination, but this
well,
is
if you had five units, you could under the even if we didn't change the buildable area, you could still with engineering build something on a steep slope, and whether that five units becomes seven units, and you can build something on there. I think it's irrelevant, or it
I mean, if you think
I'm with you,
it's complicated. It is a word that people don't seem to understand.
The bullet was just conceding that it's feasible.
Right.
That some destruction could happen.
Increased housing units.
So, yeah. So, considering you guys read it a little differently, then maybe, yeah, we could be very clear about what that means.
So, replace density with housing units?
Yeah. On parcels with steep slopes, or I don't know. I think the main thing is density, because that's just like
just
a metric, so density is not a thing.
I think we could cut out actually looking at this again, it kind of repeats itself. This change could allow for development on steep slopes
but we have already allowed for development on steep slopes. This is really about how many units could be placed
for additional development on steep slopes.
And if we want to specifically say that it's for housing, which is probably where most of that development's going to be anyway.
It seems like the disadvantages are mostly just captured by the other parts, and we could just delete that. The disadvantage in and of itself is not having more housing units.
Yeah, then I would object. I mean, I think it's a valid point. It's just a matter of how it's worded to clearly point out that we're going to allow for additional housing units on steep sites. So if...
What if you just put the reference back in that says in combination with the earlier changes to slopes, there's additional building potential?
Yeah, but you could develop these additional units without having to develop them on the steep slope.
Mm-hmm.
So it is about developing additional units. And we've already accepted the potential development on steep parts of the site.
Right, it just doesn't seem like this is a disadvantage then.
Well, I mean, you took out an inappropriate increase. So, I mean, if we want to because I think the point is that it gets to whether the housing unit density is appropriate on that site. And we're just going to allow it with this change. So if you're feeling that, I mean, the second part of the sentence is a restatement of what we already did with the previous allowance for building on steep slopes. But it may be more clarifying to leave it in. I guess I would agree with changing density to housing units if you think that's more, that's clearer, John.
Yeah, density is not, the sentence doesn't really make sense. Just saying
density of structures.
Density of structures.
We're not talking about structures either. We're just talking about housing units. That's like what the measure is, right? Otherwise,
right,
it's
yeah,
density
yeah.
of any of them.
This buildable area, so I was talking about. Yeah.
So, for increased housing units on steep sites.
So we need someone to write down what that change is, and my copy's over with Barb. So
I say, I don't know.
I'm waiting for a proposal. I can write
I would propose we just delete that second bullet.
That's what I'm hearing, and she's saying that she'll be on board with the memo anymore if we do. Which this is a majority. This bullet is essentially the majority of what mine and Barb's conversation was about. I'm trying to drill down to figure out, like, you know, what the concerns are and what the disadvantages are in this area. One thing we did discuss, which I was kind of waiting for later, but I could bring it up now since we're talking about this, is in the change that we suggested previously, we could try to give the DRB some more of a standard to apply when making a decision about engineered plans and a building on steeper slopes. Because through our conversation, and I don't want to speak for you, Barb, so feel free to chime in, but we got to a point where Barb would feel a lot better about all of this if we were making sure that the DRB was being responsible about what kinds of units and development that's happening on the slopes, which I think we all do agree with that. So if, like, beefing up that area might be a way to do put safeguards in for this area that Barb's concerned with. Anything else to add to that?
Well, I think what we talked about was the fact that given engineering plans, that people could choose to locate buildings or housing units on steep slopes in lieu of developing it on a flat set portion of the site. But I think that really does kind of touch on a different issue, maybe the previous section, more than this one.
But isn't it sort of an incentive to avoid the steep slope that you don't have to hire the engineer to prove that you can build on the steep slope? I mean,
well, you still do. I mean, you have to have an engineered plan and DRB approval.
I mean, the biggest incentive I can think of is that you have less risk to your home if you're building. Honestly,
yeah,
like,
think about
as a practical matter.
You know, there are a lot of people who choose to build
Cliff Street
on the steepest. What's that?
Even Cliff Street in town here, I mean, there are houses hanging off the side of the cliff.
Boy, there are, yeah. And undeveloped areas that are potentially subject to something like that.
So the standard I was thinking of is just something like adding some language to that, to the DRB allowance, saying, you know, some standard to the effect of, if possible, the project will take advantage of slopes of less than 30 degrees.
So, Mike, where in the standards would that fit in?
Page 316.
Okay.
We already have standards to limit the amount of disturbance clearing of existing natural vegetation in the impervious surface and to minimize potential of erosion, stormwater runoff, and flooding. Water quality impairments. not to create slopes steeper than or equal to 30% without an engineering plan. Preserves distinctive natural features, general topography of the site and existing natural vegetation. Maintain or reduce the pre-existing rate and retain the pattern of stormwater runoff that leaves the property. Produce final grade that is compatible with natural surroundings. Create a harmonious transition between graded slopes and natural terrain. Avoid creating continuous unbroken slopes or linear slopes. Contour graded slopes by varying the slope increments
to
produce final grades.
Not to, just to interrupt you here. I mean, it seems like, so everything you're reading is under 3007.H design standards, and it's all dealing with development on steep slopes. So it's to the maximum extent feasible, development on steep slopes shall be designed to, and then all of those factors that you just rattled off, plus some more that I cut you off before you got to. It almost seems like the kind of provision that we're talking about would be before that. Like maybe, you know, we'd move the H down to I and put in a new H that says, I don't know, I don't have the language in mind, but showing some sort of preference
to the maximum extent feasible development should happen on the flatter areas of the site.
Maybe we just
I was thinking another way would be just add on to sub 2 there.
Oh, yeah?
Just to clarify.
That would be easier.
Not create slopes steeper than or equal to 30% without an engineered plan to, you know. Development, I don't know. Actually, I feel like I'm going to be clumsy in anything I propose, but the gist of it would be that developing on flatter surfaces will be a priority.
Number one kind of caught that.
I think the maximum extent feasible,
limit the amount of disturbance clearing of existing natural vegetation and impervious surface.
I agree that one does, but I mean, we can.
It's not explicit.
We can put a real fine point on it. Yeah, number two.
John, you have a furrowed brow. What's troubling you?
About it. I mean, it feels like academic to think of in those terms, like when in reality that's not really how like building things work. It's not like we have like the luxury here in Montpelier to have a bunch of nice flat sites for us to build things, and like we'll choose the spot that's like less, that's hanging off the side of a cliff. And we'll end up in a situation where this goes before the DRB and they'll say, well, you've got all these better places on your property to build, so we're going to deny this. It just seems like a tortured situation that it's just clumsy, or it's a very blunt tool that we're trying to make into a scalpel to address this situation.
But we do give DRB other kinds of recommendations. I think the biggest concern that Kirby and I were talking about was developing Sabins Pasture, because that's an area that has both low slope and steep slopes. So it would be very possible for someone to choose to develop the steep slopes in advance of the lesser slopes. But
it seems like there are just so many other provisions of the bylaw that would get at.
I
could be wrong, but
minimum setback might.
All the conditional use standards, the PUD standards,
You're talking about like a just
site
plan one
requirements, just the
one building rather than a development of PUD.
No, I think it within developing probably within a PUD, but I mean maybe splitting hairs here with that particular section, and may have to find out.
I think we could write some language that kind of clarifies that, and it reiterates mostly what's already there, that there's a desire to not develop on these steep slopes, but at the same time not make it, truly make it a standard, not a rule. But if Barb would be okay with that. So what I'm proposing is not like any, rigorous new rule or anything that would.
You're talking about aspirational language, I think.
Guiding language.
Which Mike's not a big fan of in rules, because it's hard to know what to do with it.
But you can. It's fine to do as long as you've got guidelines to provide.
The regional plan has wording that discourages building on slopes over 25%. For us, we could say that we encourage building on the lower, on the flatter areas of the site in preference to the steeper sections. But I don't know if that just gets too cumbersome.
They're just like, there are so many factors. It may like not make sense to build there, right? Like, we may all agree, like, oh no, like, don't put that building like right next to the road, blocking the view of something that everyone loves, as opposed to this totally different location that makes sense. But we wrote this regulation so like the only place someone could build is like, 1 foot out of the floodplain, because that's the only flat part or something like that.
We're saying just preference. It's not saying that they have to do it, but at least they need to address why they didn't choose to do that. A preference is kind of a loose word, which I know Mike doesn't like, but.
Well, it just wouldn't have any standing in court.
Yeah, I don't see like how the city benefits from understanding someone's preference.
Oh. No, I guess, but yeah, I was interpreting preference with a little bit more scope than that. But I don't know, it's really up to you, Kirby, because you're the one who wants to insert that section.
Yeah, well, again, I think that I saw it as a way to address what your concerns are in that bullet point, because you're afraid of development on these slopes. So instead of not doing what we want to do with buildable area, let's get to the heart of it and address it here,
mm-hmm.
which is about development on steep slopes.
But not strictly on steep slopes, but all right.
So it's not, it doesn't address all of your concerns, but it addressed at least one that I thought was a big one.
It addresses the part that we've previously already accepted,
mm-hmm.
which is allowing development on steep slopes without an engineering.
Can we pin down what the concern is that we're trying to fix here or to address? Because I feel like I've lost it in the discussion.
Sure. So the memo's built of advantages and disadvantages is kind of the meat of it.
Yeah.
And the second bullet point under disadvantages is that the wording right now is this change could allow for increased density on steep sites and or development on steep slopes with an engineered plan and DRB approval. John pointed out how density's not used correctly there and that it really means residential units or units. So this change could allow for increased units on those
mm-hmm.
sites.
Change is meaning it's the allowance of building on steep slopes? That's what we're talking about?
No, the changing the buildable area.
Changing the buildable area could increase the number of units built on the steep slopes.
Yes.
Right, okay.
On steep sites.
In combination with other things, not the change by itself.
So it's a difference between the steep sites and the steep slopes.
On parcels with steep slopes. But then if we're saying you could build more housing units on places where we say it's okay for you to build, and one of our big goals is to increase the number of housing units, I fail to see like how it's a disadvantage.
And I'm with you. I'm with you on that. And Barb and I talked about that. I think it's definitely subjective to call that a disadvantage. The second part, I think, is less subjective, and that's that it could lead to development on steep slopes. So but that's mitigated if we maybe beef up the standards a little bit.
Can we pull that bullet and put it up in the description of, I mean, I'm just thinking maybe if we
this
move it.
This change could allow for increased housing units on steep sites, period.
Yeah, I mean, you could just put it.
John's concern is that he doesn't see that as a disadvantage because we want more housing.
We do want to disclose that this change could happen, right?
Yes.
But we don't agree whether it's an advantage or disadvantage. So let's disclose it in a section that's not listed under either.
Can I ask why we're bothering characterizing this in terms of advantages and disadvantages when we could just list these all as impacts?
We're trying to be as clear as possible to City Council about the decision.
As clear as it gets. I mean, the crux of this debate here for the last 20 minutes has been whether or not the inclusion of a bullet point it can be characterized as an advantage or a disadvantage. Nobody is denying that it has an impact. It's how we characterize it, so don't characterize it.
Yeah, just delete advantage and disadvantage and then rework that to say could allow for an increase in housing units on parcels with steep slopes.
And steep sites.
Mm-hmm.
Well, disadvantage was already
sites
been taken out,
slopes.
Right? Wasn't that deleted?
That seems like an elegant solution.
If the commission can't agree upon what is properly characterized as an advantage or disadvantage when outlining the impacts of the change, like, I don't know how we would expect the City Council or anybody, any other reader to not have that same problem. So let's not set that problem up for the reader.
Yeah, because then maybe we're making determinations about it too if we see something as an advantage or a disadvantage.
Right.
So you're suggesting just put all the bullet points together.
They're all just impacts.
As impacts.
Reader can, you know, a robust debate will follow.
Or
leading them down the path.
Well, I could certainly agree with that.
I don't have that strong of feelings. I do think that it's doesn't communicate as well, like what our thinking is. I think it's like that resolution means that we're just, let's just be less clear about what we're saying. And that's not what I was going for, but I also don't think the City Council is going to put as much energy into it as we have as far as so.
I don't know.
I think if we can, if we can put them all under one header that says impacts and approve the memo, we should, because you're right. We've spent a lot of time on this. I really appreciate the extra effort that Kirby and Barb have done. So if the two of you are comfortable with that, you know, it's...
Comfortable with putting all of the bullet points together.
Yeah.
Under one heading, impacts.
Yeah, and changing that one bullet in the manner John Adams described.
Just to change density to housing units.
Oh, that one.
So from density to increased units on sites with steep slopes.
Yeah. Steep site says the same thing.
You want to change the word density to units? That
to
density.
Residential units.
Residential units, okay.
Okay, change density to residential units. And leave the rest as it is.
You can, or you could say parcels with steep slopes. Just to be really clear.
Either way, the main thing is like density.
Getting rid of the density.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And maybe the second half of that gets to what you wanted to do.
I see who this
to
is coming
Kirby.
From.
So the development
okay.
on steep slopes.
Mm-hmm. I just, again, I mean, like, my suggestions about the 30% standards for the DRB is just, that was an area that I agree with Barb that, and I thought we'd all agree that we're not trying to make a change where all of a sudden it's like fair game to start building on the steepest slopes you can. Like, that's not, so adding in a little bit of clarifying language I thought would be a good way to resolve that, and I thought that was out of that bullet point, that was the part I would be concerned about. Because I agree with John that increasing density in and of itself is certainly not a disadvantage. So.
Depends on your point of view. Appropriate density, appropriate housing units, but.
Okay.
Well, thank you. Next up, under same item six. Let's talk about Mike's written report.
So, to do any update, or you want to do some new, we're required under state law to put together a zoning report that provides, gives a brief explanation of the proposed bylaw amendment, including the statement of purpose, some findings regarding how the proposal conforms with or furthers the goals and policies contained in the municipal plan, and findings regarding on how the proposal is compatible with the future land uses and densities in the municipal plan. So I put together a memo that really just kind of outlines what's there. You guys opportunities to give any comments. We certainly can make amendments if we need to at a later date too, but we have to send the required report out with the warning. In the public hearing. One of these things planners really wish the state would just get rid of. The only thing it's good for is lawyers to sue planning directors.
Not personally.
Yes, personally.
Oh, God.
So it's just one of these ones that they find little loopholes of, well, you didn't follow that one word.
So how does this last part about where you're referencing the master plan, that comes as part of this report because all of these sections are being affected?
Well, the second one, how the proposal conforms with or furthers the goals and policies contained in the municipal plan.
That's a statutory requirement.
That's the statutory requirement of what I've got to talk about. So the master plan adopted in 2017 identifies goals. So 2F.
Okay, so it just identifies the particular goals that these address.
Yeah. Yeah, the zoning talked about some of these. A couple of these I could have eliminated for maybe for the amendment. But the steep slopes does affect the earth extraction. Increasing densities.
Well, this is going to be finalized after the public hearing, right?
We could finalize it then.
So, it looks fine to me now.
It's mostly what I pulled from the zoning, when we did the zoning adoption.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd like to just take some time on it.
Yeah, so we can.
I haven't had time to really look at this.
Yeah, so we can all take some time with it, and then we can incorporate any other changes that we may make as a result of the public hearing. So we'll just.
So this doesn't have to go to the council beforehand as an explanation of the change?
No, I believe it goes, it's a part of the package that all, it goes all at once.
It goes to ACCD, it goes to neighboring towns, it goes to the Regional Planning Commission, and it goes to, I think there's a fourth one in there.
The lawyers.
The lawyers.
Yeah.
They'll find out which one I missed.
So it's after approval by City Council?
Well, no. It's after our public hearing. And
I need to send this with the public hearing notice to others, but
to
others, okay.
Yeah, for the Planning Commission public hearing.
Oh, okay.
How much? Oh, wait, if we're talking about the 8th, then what's the timeline on that?
I think it's just 15 days. So
okay.
If I got comments in the next 15 days, I can.
Okay.
But let me check, because they conveniently make things just a little bit different for each one.
So I'm confused. This would be sent in and then to the council in 15 days.
Doesn't go to the council.
So the okay, so we're working against a suggested public hearing date of April 8th. And we need to get 15 days notice before that public hearing. And we need to send this out as part of that notice. So if we're calculating 15 days backwards from April 8th,
I see.
Then that puts us at whatever the deadline is for getting this out.
The only purpose of this is because it's required by law to send along with the proposed changes. Most towns just write, like, we're changing the zoning to make it better.
Right, no, it
makes far more detail.
Well, then
it makes sense to have this.
Yeah,
it's just a question, because it says it going to city council, but I thought I heard Mike say it was not.
Yeah, it is. It's just not, it's the initial notice for the public hearing goes to the other guys. This will go to city council once you guys are done.
So is 15 days counting weekends or not?
Counts weekends, 15 actual days.
The old question day.
Warned public hearing, not less than 15 days.
See, Mike, we're not one of those lawyers that would ever sue a city plan. We don't even know.
Don't even know how to sue you.
So March, Sunday, March 24th.
Yes, 15 days. Yeah.
So the 22nd, Friday the 22nd would be the day.
Yeah.
Okay.
22nd would give us extra.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, if you don't mind, I'd like to just spend some time with it and I'll send it to the group if I have anything. I probably don't.
Yep.
I'll take a look at
it. Yeah. Why don't we each send comments that we have to Mike and he can compile them and send us a new draft. I don't know, within a week. If everyone gets him comments by the end of this week, what's the date? The 15th. And then Mike can get us a revised version a couple days later, like on the 19th.
Okay. So by 15th.
And, assuming we won't have any issues, then we can send it out on the 22nd.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Mike, did you send this out in a PDF or a Word document?
It was part of the...
I don't know which one I sent.
It's okay.
I could try to resend it in Word. Or
no, don't worry about it.
You just send it out with the package.
Yeah.
I don't remember. I just hit print. I didn't.
Yeah, that's what I do too. Except unless it's got colors, and I don't. Okay.
Oh, I actually don't. I don't think I have a copy of that. Did you send that out in the last batch of stuff a couple days ago?
It was on Friday.
I sent it Friday.
It was in Word.
Except it's maybe titled a little bit funny.
It's, yeah, Unified Development Regulations, blah, blah, blah.
Oh, that's
something
it.
Something report.
It's in, it's in Word.
Report.
It's a Word version, so.
Right, perfect. You can do that.
Yeah.
Great.
It also references a proposed land use map. Is that a change that we're making?
We are making a change to the land use map, this guy.
Oh, because...
That's a change to the map.
Okay, but we haven't talked about that.
Well, yeah, it's already been approved. It was already approved on the matrix.
Oh, so which... All right.
Refresh our memories,
yeah.
Mike.
North Street.
Okay, that's part of it. Let's
yeah,
this is
right.
North Street.
Yeah.
Okay.
Keep going.
This was there's the river. There's North Street. Actually, if you were over here on Elm Street, you can see a little house over here. It was built on the hillside.
Mm-hmm.
So these guys went and this property sold and had a new house built on it. And these guys knew each other. And these guys always wanted to have more land, so they... did a boundary line adjustment to add more land to his property so he had a little bit more room. But because he had the parcel that was on the edge of the zoning map,
right.
He now had a split parcel. Half of his parcel or two-thirds of his parcel are in one zone and one-third of his parcel is in another zone. So we figured this move the zoning boundary.
Yeah,
not to
yeah.
do that.
Thank
yeah.
you. Okay,
nope.
so
yeah.
I think we need to vote to set the date for the public hearing. Suggested date is April 8th. Do I have a motion to set April 8th as the date for the public hearing for the zoning changes?
To move.
Okay, any discussion about that? Are we going to have a quorum for that? April.
I probably won't be there.
So John, Stephanie, and Barb are going to be gone. We have to all be there.
So.
I'll do my best.
Okay, so that's.
Yeah, so
do we have to be there for the public?
We need to have a quorum to
no
open
one's
it.
Here.
Oh, to open it.
Yeah, so that was.
I mean, it'll look good.
Dear public,
well,
please thank
yeah,
your comments.
Right, but I mean, certainly
if
didn't have quorums for this council
public
hearing.
You can always call John
and
say, just
hop
on 10 minutes.
Yeah, assuming I'm not at Gifford.
Well, those were working
I could probably
groups.
Do it in a
pitch. For the hearing, the actual hearing that occurred. There were only two actual hearings at the city council.
All right, so hearing no more discussion, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay, motion carries, and the meeting date is set for April 8th.
Actually, number 7 was kind of hitting both of those.
So. Item 7 is motion to warn a hearing on April 8th to consider the draft amendment to the Unified Development Regulations. So we set the hearing date, but did we accomplish this, Mike? And
I think we did that.
Yeah, I think that would technically follow that.
So will
meet
we get
same
a
spirit.
Will we get a final copy of all the changes?
All the strikeout ones?
Yeah.
Would you like a hard copy, or do you want me to because I think I emailed you a digital copy.
He emailed the digital copy.
Oh,
you can
okay.
take my
well,
hard copy.
I just didn't
copy.
Know if there was anything.
Yeah,
I guess we only made a few questions.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Mike, maybe would you mind making sure that
changes.
We have a few copies printed for the actual hearing?
Yes. Well, I have to. I have to have copies in downstairs, and I have to have some copies.
The
so.
strikeout ones.
Yeah.
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 Okay.
Officially, that's what we are going to be adopting. We went through the matrix, but officially,
this
it
is
going
actual.
To be what is in the strikeout copy. With the changes we made today, which were on 424, 423, and 315, those three pages we made typo fixes.
Oh, okay. Well, that's all
yeah.
it is. I can just look at what you emailed.
So. Yeah.
The date on that previous draft was February 19th.
Yep.
Okay.
So I will make those three changes and.
Yes.
And then we can.
That's right. So as far as the hearing process, we'll, Mike, are you up for giving a quick overview of kind of the approach that we took and the types of changes that we.
I will come prepared and we'll see.
Okay.
Who shows up and how many people show up, and we can kind of take it from there.
Okay.
I mean, if we don't get a lot of input or we get one or two people, we can probably answer their questions.
Mm-hmm.
If we get a bigger crowd, then it makes sense to kind of do an overview of it. And if we don't get anybody, then we can move on to the city plan.
Okay.
Do we typically get a draw of people?
Well, my experience here is that yes.
Yes,
I think we can anticipate some
fairly good size
comments.
Is typically just one hearing? Is that correct?
For the Planning Commission, there's one required hearing. We can have as many hearings as we
okay.
want, as
yeah.
we had with the last adoption. We had multiple rounds of hearings.
Right.
So.
Yeah.
Okay. So that we. Blues are item 7. So item 8 is the city plan. Identify this year's milestones toward completion. Discuss the presentation from Sustainable Montpelier Coalition and next steps. So like I mentioned, we had a little bit of a working session at our last meeting since we didn't have a quorum. And the big takeaways I had were that the Sustainable Montpelier Coalition presentation was really valuable for giving us ideas about the potential for our city. And the next step is to kind of start marking on a map which of those we feel we should pursue. So a lot of information is going to go into that. Some is, you know, if we want to review various documents that Mike's going to be uploading under the Google Drive, we're going to be seeking public comment that will also give us information on that. Of course, we have the master plan that we can look to for ideas. You know, we don't have to just pull these out of thin air. So, but I think the most comprehensive way to start the process is to actually pull up a map in one of our meetings, look at it together, and talk about various things. So we can decide whether we want to talk about a portion of the city or if we want to talk about transportation needs throughout the city, and we can just have an organic discussion. And since it was your idea, John, with the map, you want to give any more background or details?
We have this tool, I guess, that Stern Environmental is developing that'll give us basically the ability to collect information on a map from the community in like a very easy to use way, either using your phone or online or something. And it would probably make sense for as soon as that's available, for us to be the first to take it for a test drive and start to populate it with things. And the idea of framing it with like degrees of change. So what do we want in our community? What do we want to transform? What do we want to either improve? And what do we want to maintain as like a productive way of capturing people's ideas around specific areas in the town. But short of, I could come up with something quickly, but we probably would just want to do this once, and if Stone's going to do it, probably want to wait until that's ready. The other part of this is, so we have the website that I started last year that everyone has access to, as a place where we'll put some material, and in that I worked with Barbara. She gave me the Energy Committee sort of goals and plans, and I tried to work them into a format that could serve as a template for other communities and for ourselves in terms of how do we want to break out, how do we want people to give us information so that it's useful and in a way that's consistent with other committees and other people, and how we'll end up using it in the end. So also so that it ends up being practical as opposed to a 300-page document that we feel relieved to be completed with and never look at again. In the folders there, and I can send just a direct link, which will be easier.
Yeah.
There's, I don't know if you've had a chance to look at it, Barbara, but
I didn't because I guess I misunderstood when we were looking at it just on the last session. It wasn't clear to me how much information was actually in there from the energy goals. So you actually have incorporated it at different levels.
I did, and I boiled it down quite a bit from what was there, and essentially has it as, you know, one maybe vision statement, and then goals and measures, so basically measurable goals that I think the committee had a lot of, so I put those in there, and then strategies, and strategies could be policies or actions to accomplish those goals.
So there are three levels. Vision.
There's three
goals,
levels. Yeah.
And then
vision, a single statement that talks about what, you know, where we want to go. Goals that are actual measurable. So like, how do we know if we'd attained that vision? We should be able to check off those measurable goals, and then the strategies. And in it, I also have like a evaluation matrix that we may not want to get into now, but I thought it would be worth bringing up as a, you know, where are we going with this? And also as something to communicate for committees to think of. And I just proposed these, but we can talk about what makes sense, but to look at what is the effectiveness of a proposed strategy or action, what are the effort or resources required, what are the any existing programs or projects related to this, what are the timelines, what are the supporting documents, like how fleshed out is this idea, because some things will be, you know, already on their way and very developed, others will be, may just be pie in the sky ideas, and then responsible parties, anticipated costs, and partners. That way when we bring all of these together, we can look at, you know, what is the highest, where do we get the biggest bang for our buck, and start to prioritize what the different strategies are, and hopefully the people or the committees or folks who've come up with these ideas can understand that we'll have to make some hard decisions, or like that's the challenge of this, is actually finding those strategies that are going to make it the biggest difference, and try to have them work with us in looking at this, rather than with the idea that everyone submits ideas and we'll accept all of them and put them into a plan, which is easy to do. We're not doing anyone any favor by doing that.
So you're suggesting we would prioritize, not each individual group?
Well, they can fill out the matrix if they'd like, but that would maybe something we go back to them, because it can be a lot to come up with all of that and then to evaluate it. You probably want to get them all together and then evaluate them in context, right?
But if they had at least had the evaluation matrix, then it might give them a better idea of what areas to emphasize in terms of giving us information, if I'm reading this.
Yeah, or that we'll be going back to them and that this will be evaluated under this criteria. So.
Right. I mean, so they could identify what resources there are, you know, each one of these line items. So we don't have to do that work. It's really up to them.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. Is it possible for us to work with some kind of a map prior to relying on the stone environmental map? Might be just a much simpler method. As Leslie was saying, you know, maybe we look at a map and we address transportation throughout the city. And then we look at another copy of the map and we address, you know, one of the other topics. Housing or something like that, just to try and sort of put a graphic interface into this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we can.
As a group.
We could also just actually have a map and start drawing it up at our meetings.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
We started that.
That's what I mean, yeah. So if we could have large scale, I mean a large map that we can all work on top of. Sure. You can always do it as overlays on a single map.
I'd like it if we could start that at the next meeting.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we have a map that it should be somewhere on the site that has a lot of the layers that you can toggle on and off.
Is it possible to print? Is it possible to print?
I wouldn't print from it. I mean, you could.
Okay, well, yeah, I guess
Do you want paper copies, or do you want to just get digital and project it up?
I think we should just project it.
I think, or if we have a paper one, but I just bring up that so we don't have the need to overlay everything on it, because we can access that digitally, other than looking at something that's like, we put too much on it, and then we can't figure out what we're looking at anymore.
Yeah, I guess I was thinking about doing it physically as overlays. So, you know, we have a base map that has, I don't know how much information we want to include, and then look at each specific area. But it might be useful to draw, you know, to pull up that those individual maps, those layers you have, to give us some background as we're looking at the whole thing. Mm-hmm. So, but I think we need to be able to actually get in, at least I do, get into it as a graphic tool.
Mm-hmm. So I don't see it on the actual, on our little planning website yet.
Okay.
So
I might have taken it down because we stopped talking about the city plan.
So if you go to plan.montp.city, you can pull up our little mm-hmm. website that John made. So if I don't know if you want to.
It's pretty great for a unused website at this point. I think you did a great job on it. You really did.
Yeah.
So if you could send us that link again, John. You sent it in a previous email, right?
To the
Yeah,
I can send you the link to that, and then also just the spreadsheet for the energy goals.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that would be great.
Yeah, I'm sending it right now.
Okay.
I already got it. Well.
Because I tried pulling it up with plan.montp.city, and I did not get it.
So speaking of overlays, did you guys discuss sort of the different buckets or areas that we want to discuss or we want to incorporate into the plan?
Well, only generally.
Yeah.
Nothing, no focus discussion on that.
We have the list of
one of the buckets are
chapter top chapters.
Yeah, I figured that.
Yeah, that most of them.
Yeah, so Aaron, there's a list of chapters. And who would be responsible
both
for
candy
those.
Stores.
Is that on that website?
I don't know.
I just don't think that's on the website.
It'll
start to get over
curious.
There. Because we've got to set up a folder for each one of them so I can start. Otherwise, you're just going to end up with a giant library of unorganized documents.
No.
So I kind of have to make
folders.
Yeah, make an energy folder that I'll have some subfolders in that'll have like resources, either general resources or Montpelier specific.
Right, so then they can start to populate that with their resources.
Yeah,
because
that's what I had started to do on my own just to work through it first was to just set up different subfolders. So under housing, there were different subfolders so I would know where to start chucking things if I find them.
So it seems like we have a good idea of how we're going to get feedback and information from the committees. Did you talk about how we'll incorporate the public feedback along the way?
Oh, nice. Thanks.
The idea was with that map, the tool from Stone.
Okay.
But having meetings, actually having public hearings to get feedback.
Well, there will be,
certainly.
The discussion that we've been having in the past was that we have a plan that has a lot of visions, and what we wanted to do is to start to make a more strategic plan. So we were going to kind of reorganize the plan and kind of go back to the committees to kind of write plans for the historic chapter would have something that's going to be worked out with the Historic Preservation Committee, and to try to make it more strategic. And then kind of go to the public with, after working with the committees, because the committees are made up of members of the public, too. Each one of those meetings would be open to the public. And then just to start to work our way back to taking all the pieces and then putting the pieces into a plan and then getting back to having, more public outreach on each one of these pieces, which I think is where the Access Montpelier will be very helpful when that comes online, the Stone product, because we'll be able to...
Right, Access Montpelier, that's the name of it.
Yeah. And so if we get that all going, and we're going to have multiple ways of reaching out, and I think as with the zoning process, we're going to, this plan won't be 200 pages, but, the zoning was 200 pages, and we spent tons and tons of time discussing probably about 15 of them. I think the city plan is going to be a lot the same, where we're going to come up with a lot of goals, policies, recommendations, and a lot of it, people are going to kind of go and say, well, this is what we do, and this is good. And then a couple of sections that, you know, we're going to...
Friction.
Create some friction, and you know, different. There are going to be different groups. It's just out there. You know, we've got people who, the merchants and folks, very concerned about making sure there's enough parking for customers, and another group that wants bike lanes, and another group that wants no cars. So inherently, we're going to have to make a decision as to what our recommended policies are, and somebody's not going to be happy with that. We're going to hear about it. The point is for us to have this, to put stuff out there for people to start to react to. And
what committee is going to inform us the most on parking?
Transportation committee.
Okay.
I mean, you're going to hear from MEAC because there's a portion of them that has a, you know, sees the cars as a conflict point for bikes, and you know, a limited of them that think parking is, you know, cars are going to be a thing of the future and, you know, or a thing of the past.
Yeah.
And they're not going to be here anymore, and we don't have to be planning for them. We shouldn't be building parking garages.
What about complete streets?
And
complete streets is going to be the parking, it's going to be the transportation plan.
Okay,
so
that's
as you talk
the name
to the transportation
the plan, okay.
committee, they're going to be, this transportation plan, we'll draw heavily on the complete streets plan, because that's really the policy that the city has taken. To identify where the bike lane should be, to identify where the on-street parking should be, and to establish a plan and a map. And that'll probably tell us a lot about that, you know, our maintain, evolve, transform is looking at, you know, where are the gaps in that complete streets, where we have streets that completely don't match what our ideal future is.
And that policy has been adopted by City Council.
The complete streets plan has,
yeah.
Yeah,
okay. We were looking at a number of different transportation plans and weren't certain if that one had been.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that.
Yeah, okay. We've got a long, long history of lots of transportation plans in the city.
Yeah, so, I mean, there's a lot of things that will go into the transportation plan, not just that. You know, there is the public transit and a couple other pieces, but
okay.
Certainly the overall picture. Yeah,
rail. Jan, do you just want to give us a quick?
There is a map on the website.
Sorry,
it probably needs
it.
To be updated because it's from August 2017. But there's an interactive map there that you can go and toggle on. Just a whole pile of layers. And again, I'll probably take a look at this and see what's still relevant and what isn't. May have like some draft zoning that
we
may
have some old zoning regulations that aren't quite the same.
So is that on our site?
It is. I think it's sort of buried in there. I was just looking for things to content to put onto it, but under learn more.
Yeah. So if, yeah,
I just emailed that the link to this page.
Unbury that. That would help in for us to just kind of maybe look at before the next meeting. So, Mike, are you going to be able to provide some kind of a hard copy, large physical map for us to work over?
Are we looking for just one per meeting?
Do we have one with, like, just a big ortho?
Just with ortho and parcel lines? Or just...
Yeah, that would probably...
Just one we could put on the table for the next meeting.
And then we could do tracing paper overlays.
2x3?
All of it. That would be good.
Do you have tracing paper?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so bring that.
Can you bring that? Yeah.
Parcels.
And markers.
Great.
That's when it gets fun.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Markers are fun.
Colored.
Okay. Sound good for the next meeting on that? So I sent the link to the map. If anyone wants to play around with it, you can do that. I sent it in your email. So we have some meeting minutes we should blow through right now and try to get approved. Starting with January 28th. Let's see. Okay.
I just had one question. Under the punch list for zoning fixes, number four, gravel to whether or not they would need a permit to change from gravel to pavement, I believe it was, yes. And I thought that we actually had voted on the matrix that they would need a permit. But it looks like this discussion says that we don't need, they don't need a permit.
No, I think if you read, I mean, my read of it is that they do. It says, Mike recommended, this is the second to last sentence, Mike recommended that if it's a new surface, it requires a permit, repaving is maintenance. Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Repaving.
But repaving a paved surface, is that what that means? An already paved, or?
Yes,
right.
It was an already, it was a gravel surface being paved, for example.
Mike, do you recall what we?
Because I remember in our matrix discussion.
I guess I thought that meant repaving it, but maybe I'm totally, something that was already, that was not gravel, that was paved, but.
Pave a gravel path, and it says either material is an impervious surface.
I know I had it here.
I've got the matrix.
So we could keep track of that impervious surface that Kirby stated if they got a permit.
So the decision, PC agrees to regulate paving of unpaved surfaces.
Okay, so I guess that would mean that we changed our position from number four in a later date. Sorry, can you read that again, Mike?
PC agrees to regulate paving of unpaved surfaces.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I mean, it doesn't matter. We could have made that decision then and changed our decision later. I'm just bringing it up as a point. If somebody goes back and reads our minutes.
We didn't change our decision later, I don't think. I think that was the decision, so we should make this clear. So my proposal is that we change the last sentence from the consensus was in agreement with that recommendation to the consensus was in agreement to regulate, well, whatever Mike just read was
to
our...
To regulate paving of unpaved surfaces.
To regulate.
Okay.
Thank you for catching that. Anything else with these? Do I have a motion to approve with that amendment?
So moved.
Second?
I'll second.
Any other discussion on this? All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? Okay. January 28th, meeting minutes are approved without change. February 11th. I have a motion to approve these. Second from anyone here?
Second.
Okay, 5 seconds. Any discussion? This is our. Okay, all those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? Okay. February 11th, meeting minutes approved. February 25th.
Move to approve.
Barb, you've got to be the one to second this one.
I do?
Yeah. We're running out of,
the only
running
other
out of
person
people.
There.
Oh, because, oh, do we even have minutes?
Technically, she wrote minutes anyways because she had a copy of the.
Yeah, we might as well approve them, I mean.
Oh, okay. I'm sure. I'll second.
Okay. All those in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. Okay, good. I'll vote on that one. Okay, they're approved.
I move to adjourn.
Okay, I have a second.
I will second that.
Oh,
the eternal meeting.
Yes.
Okay. It's a non-debatable motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, and we are adjourned. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Mike, what if-